Tov, everyone. Hope you had a great Shabbaton here. I'm sure you have. So we have about 40 minutes to talk. If you have questions in the end, please feel free to ask. I understand you're all high school girls, 16, 17. So the right topic to speak to you about is two things. One is the proper connection to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And the second thing is the most important thing in the life of a Jewish woman. Who knows what it is?
Marriage.
Yes. Very good. I'm sure you heard about it at least 1,000 times before. And I'm sure you're going to hear about it at least another 1,000 times again. And even if you hear about it one more million times, it still won't be enough because the Yetzer Hara is a genius. The Satan is not a fool. And it's going to fool you nonstop, day after day, week after week, and it's a battle. Just that it's very difficult for a man to focus always on learning and learning, and the Torah will be the main thing in his life. The Yetzer Hara does not give a rest. Same thing by the ladies. Tznius, the Satan, is putting all his efforts to bring a woman down in this level in Tznius, because once he does that, he basically destroys her. Why Tznius is such an important thing? There's keeping Shabbos. The Torah says Mechal Shabbos is cutting himself out of Judaism. Chas v'shalom, it's death penalty, it's not a joke. There's other averos in the Torah, you should not kill, to be a thief, it's horrible. There's a lot of bad things. Why Tznius is the highlight in the life of a Jewish woman? The answer is because there are two categories of sinners. One, it's a person committing sins between him and Hashem. And one is a person committing sin not only between him and Hashem, he actually makes an impact on so many other people to make sins as well. That's called machti harabim, that a person influences other people to commit sins. The difference is huge, because when you make a sin between you and Hashem, it's one and another one and another one and another one. It adds up to thousands or sometimes to tens of thousands. But if a person wants to do tshuva, at least there is a chance. Once a person is machti harabim for a long time, meaning one of the ways to be machti harabim is when a woman is not dressed properly according to halacha in a strict modesty, and she behaves in a non-modest way, too loud, attracting attention, too much makeup, perfume, all the things that a kosher lady should be very, very careful with. You know, the type of shoes, the length of the skirt, if the clothes are wide enough, all these things that obviously I'm sure you learn about. If a woman is not careful with that, and she attracts attention while she's not properly dressed and behave according to modesty, to halacha, every bad thought and every sin that will happen as results of that goes to her account, which can come to millions. The Gemara says, Machti Rabin, En Maspikim Biyado Lasot Tshuva. Someone that commits sins, he doesn't have the merit enough to do tshuva. But we see in reality, there are many people that used to be very wicked people, and eventually they did tshuva. We see in our generation people that used to be movie stars, DJs in radio, people that do all kinds of mixed weddings, dancing, and many of them, I have many of the Talmidim, Baruch Hashem, and I had the zechut to make them Baalei Tshuva. Today they yeshivot, they're very, very strict. So what does it mean, the Gemara? Well, the Gemara doesn't know what they're talking about. They say, Machti Arabim, En Maspikim Biyado Lasot Tshuva. I can give you 1,000 Machti Arabim that in the last 21 years that I made them Baalei Tshuva. At least 1,000. Machti Arabim, besides all the others. So what's going on here? Well, the Gemara say one thing, in reality is the opposite. Let's explain what it means. Avraham Avinu had a father, his name was Terach. I'm sure you heard about him. Terach was Machti Arabim. What does he mean, Machti Arabim? He used to sell getchkes, all kinds of, you know, statues, Avodah Zarah, idols. As a result of Terach, even the Goyim, by the way, in case you didn't know, the Goyim have Sheba Mitzvot Bnei Noach, one of them, they cannot worship any idols. They have to believe in one God. If a goy believes in more than one god, or son of God, or an idol, or any, he gives power to the stars or to any other thing, that's a violation of the seven laws of Noah. And it makes the goy a wicked goy. The goy keeps the Sheva Mitzvot Bnei Noach, is a righteous goy. And even he has a share to the world to come of the goyim. Goyim can have Olam Haba in a limited way, but if they keep the Sheva Mitzvot Bnei Noach. So the idea is like this. The father of Avraham Avinu, Terach, most of his life was wicked and was selling idols to all the people. Before the end of his life, he did tshuva. He became Baal Tshuva, he stopped. Avraham Avinu obviously became very famous in the world. He was spreading the belief in one God. And his father Terach, as results of that, in a later date, he became Baal Tshuva. Was it enough for him? He had to come back in reincarnation. Who was he in his next life? His soul came in a different body. He came back as Eov. Eov was not Jewish, a goy prophet. Eov suffered horrible life. Up to certain point, everything was fine. And then from then on, his children died, he lost his money, he had sicknesses, problems, until he got to the point that he asked Hashem, maybe you made a mistake between Eov and Oyev. In Hebrew, it's the same letters in a different order. Eov and Oyev. You know, he said to Hashem, I'm not your enemy. Why are you so strict with me? Why are you giving me so many problems? What's the reason why? Because Terach, when he did tshuva, even though from now on he did not commit sins, all the sins that he did commit until the age that he became a Baal Tshuva, there were so many that the X amount of years that he lived as a righteous goy was not enough. Same thing by the Jews and much more. If a Jew lived 40, 50 years and make a lot of sins and he influenced the public to make sins, he can turn to tens of millions. And then when he's 50, he become a real tzaddik. He sits, he learns, he gives tzedakah, he's working on his midos, and he becomes mamash yerei shamayim. It's not enough. Why? Because even if he did 20, 30 years of mitzvot, 50 years before, he made millions of people commit sins. And that's the problem. And that's why it's very dangerous when a woman is machtiyat harabim. She's not watching her modesty 100%. Eventually, if one day she does become charedi, for real, she becomes really modest, she still has 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. And Baruch Hashem, you're very young. You just started your life. Now it's the time to wake you up. Not in 5, 10 years from now. Because if you will follow the moda, what became the style in many places with the long shadows that goes all the way down and the high heels and the short, tiny skirts and all these things that is mamash averot chamurot meot. If Chas v'Shalom you fall into this moda, into this style, it will be very difficult later on to do tshuva. Why? Because it's gaining so many problems. Every time a man looks, a Jew, non-Jew, everywhere people look, or even women that look and think, what a Chilul Hashem, the way she dressed. Chilul Hashem is a very serious problem. Chilul Hashem, even Yom Kippur does not help it. Even the day of the death does not help it. Only after a person dies, he can erase the Chilul Hashem. The way to do, or to overcome Chilul Hashem means to do Kiddush Hashem. It's not easy to do Kiddush Hashem. Because you have to make sure that you do so many public things that the eyes of the people, you know, the attention of the people, oh wow, what a Kiddush Hashem this woman made, in order for you to erase the Chilul Hashem you made before. It's really, really not simple. I always say, why to run with a credit card shopping, get it to the maximum $10,000, $20,000, and then pay with penalty and interest? Be careful how much you spend, and you won't run and lose control. Same thing right now. Right now, you are in the beginning of your life. Soon, Bezrat Hashem, in a few years, you'll all be married, and then you'll become even more severe, because Eshet Ish, it's even a lot worse than a single girl. And Chas v'Shalom, if you're not gonna go in the right direction, and it's not enough that the school teach you the right thing. Schools usually do a good job, but the streets is a war zone. And when you're done with school and you're on your own and your husband is at college or at work, whatever the case would be, the influence of the world is tremendous. Women from the previous generation that grew up without internet, without telephones, without screens everywhere, without people are not modest in the street. 40, 50 years ago, even the goyot used to dress properly. In the 1970s in the United States, when they had a public school, public, for boys and girls together, goyim. It was boys in one side of the building and girls on the other side. There was a huge wall between them. The women come from one street, the girls, and the men come from another street, 40 years ago only. Today, if you go to a public school, it's like going on a beach. People there have no respect. Every other word is a curse. People are naked. People speak firah. You cannot put your kid 1 minute over there. It's mamash murder. To put a kid today in public school, mamash a murder of the neshama. Metal detector, bullying, people steal the $5-$10 that he has in his pocket, beating him up. Not to talk about other issues that I don't even want to mention here because Baruch Hashem, you all kosher girls. You better not even hear about it, but just that you understand what a world we live in. HaKadosh Baruch Hu has only 13.2 million Jews in the world. And unfortunately, 11 million of them are still not from. They have no idea what they live for. They don't know what it means, what's the purpose of life, what Shabbat is, what does it mean kosher food, what does it mean emunah, what does it mean vekut b'kadosh baruch hu, what does it mean to open a page of Gemara and to learn. They have no idea what it is. So the 2.5 million Jews in the world that knows who is Hashem, they know what the Torah is, many of them unfortunately are too modern. They're mamash, almost conservative. If you take from how many are really, really frum, if you take the fakers out and all the people that pretend that they're frum, but then they do horrible things behind the scene, maybe there are a million people that make Hashem happy. In a world of 7.5 billion, maybe 1 million people doing nachat ruach to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Do you want to be in this group? Or you don't want to be in this group? That's the question you have to ask yourself today when you're 16, 17. Do I want to be in that one VIP league, the 1 million people that make Hashem every day happy and for that it keeps the world going? Or chas v'shalom, I want to go to the side of the faker and the losers and all the reshaim and all the non-modest people and the thieves and the murderers and all kinds of other things. Do I want to be in the right side or I want to be in the fake side? This is a question you have to ask yourself every day. I made a series, it's called Path to the Just. Mesilat Yesharim. It's based on a legendary book of the Ramchal. You know, Mesilat Yesharim, Path to the Just. Maybe it's the best Musar book ever written. Maybe, according to many opinions. It speaks about the purpose of life, the purpose of the creation, how a person reached Vekut in Hashem. What does it mean to be Hasid? Today when you say Hasidish Jew, I'm Hasidish, right, the first thing comes to the mind of the people is fair hat, right? Kugel, chulent, Hasidish accent, all kinds of other Hasidish customs, you know, mikveh every day, you know, and other few things that relates to Hasidish. None of it mentioned in the book of the Ramchal. Nobody cares so much in Shamayim, but if you ate kigel, or you ate gefilte fish, or you ate spicy food, that's not going to bring it to heaven. What makes a person tzaddik, and then midat chasidut, which is above a tzaddik. Tzaddik, it's what's required by law. You should not steal, I'm not stealing. You should keep Shabbat, I'm keeping Shabbat. Chasid means, whatever you told me to do, I'm willing to do even extra. More. Not only what's required by law, I'm even more than what. Someone owe me money, I can take him to Bedin. I'm mochel. It's okay. I'll count on Hashem. If Hashem wants, he'll give it back to me. This is midat chasidut. Girls can reach midat chasidut as well. The Gemara say kimchit. There was a woman named kimchit. She had 7 sons. Each one of them was Kohen Gadol. To become a Kohen Gadol, that means you're the most important tzaddik in the world. From all the Kohanim, you are able to enter Kodesh HaKodashim and to come out alive. Somebody that has one thought inside Kodesh HaKodashim and he comes out, one thought, and he comes out, he won't come up, he die inside. One thought that is not connected to the service of Yom Kippur when he goes inside for a few minutes, they have to pull the body with a rope because nobody is allowed to go in. She had seven sons, one after the other. It's unheard of. They told her, what's your merit that each one of your sons reached the highest level possible? She said, Me'olam lo ra'u korot beti et sa'aroshi. I am so modest that even the walls in my house never saw the hair in my head. That's how modest I was when I was alone, when I was inside, when there's no one around. I was always modest in front of Hashem. By the way, you should know one thing. Some of the women think, when it comes to the public, of course I'm modest. When I go up to the street, if I'll be married, I'll cover my hair. I will dress properly. But if I'm alone in my bedroom, who's watching? I'm alone. I can wear things that are not modest. I'm alone. It's allowed. You're right. No one is there. But think again. Why? Because there are souls of wicked people always reincarnated in space. There are spirits around us all the time. There are spirits, there are angels, there are demons. They're watching. So if a person is not modest, somebody else is watching. Yes, you're right. People cannot run and tell the world that they saw you inside your room. But there are other spirits watch you. It doesn't get you scared that somebody else can watch that a person is not modest. The person has to be tzanua, even the chadre chadarim, inside the bathroom, there's halachot, how to get dressed, how, even inside the bathroom, in the Torah, there's halachot, how to behave. Why? No one is in the bathroom. Hashem, Eloko la'aretz kvodo, Hashem is watching. Ayin, ro'ah, ve'ozen shomad, ve'chol ma'asecha ba'sefer nichtavim. There's an eye who watch you, there's a he who listens to you, and everything you do is registered in the book of God. So modesty, obviously, we can talk about it for hours, but I think you got the point of what I said. If you want to hear a little bit further, I have a lecture. It's called Modesty. A few of them. You can listen to the whole thing. You have to think about it, that it's the most important thing. If you will have that, this and Shabbos is already 90% of your life. If you go on a test, right? If you pass those two tests, Modesty and Shabbat, you're already in a very, very high level. Because this is the main two things in the life of a woman. Now, one more thing. How does a girl or a woman in general get closer to Hashem? She doesn't sit in 10 hours a day to learn Gemara and to feel the light of the Torah. She has all kinds of things that she's busy with. Children, shopping, cooking. Women has a lot of other obligations in life. In between all the headache that a woman has in her life, how she can find the time to feel that she's close to Hashem, that she has moments that tears come from her eyes and she feels so connected and so close to Hashem. The answer is, the best way, who knows, what's the best way for a human being, anyone, to be very, very close to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Very, very close. Who knows what it is? That you feel the world doesn't exist. It's you and him and nothing else exists.
Tefillah,
it's very good. But there is a way a little bit even higher than that. Because in a tefillah, you request all kinds of things. Help me with this, help me with that. It's a little bit selfish. I want this, I want that, help me, do. It's not so pure. Rabbi Zion Abba Shaul Zatzal, one of the biggest rabbis in our generation, passed 20 years ago. Was the biggest mekubal in the world also. He said, if Chazal did not write that tefillah, I would say that it's azut, meaning chutzpah, to have so many requests. Just give us life and we good. Who are we to ask from Hashem? Give me this, give me that. A list of requests every day, three times. Imagine you come to Obama. Three times a day, I want this, I want that, I want discount on my taxes, I want that, I want to get into the school. Help me out, you're the president. Three times a day, 20 years.
Hashem has mercy and he has kindness. Obama does not.
It's very different. I looked at that as an obvious, but if you say it right, we know already the difference between Hashem and Obama. Yeah. Thank you for
elaborating.
But you get the idea here that Hashem, that we come to Hashem three times a day with a list of requests. It's not 100% Hashem Shamayim. We still have something in it. But I'm asking, what is a way to connect to Hashem in such a way that the world is mamash, doesn't exist? You feel like you're going out of this world. The answer? Tehillim. Reading Tehillim. But not reading Tehillim. Not reading Tehillim like most women read.
Reading it with Kabbalah.
Just to finish it and to run to work or to run to cook. No. Healing has 150 chapters. I made a series about it in English, explaining every word, every verse, and why David HaMelech wrote it, what situation was he in, what's the secret behind it. Tehillim part 1 and 2, 39 lectures. Once you listen to it, the reading of Tehillim will never be the same. Because now, at least when you read this Mizmor, you know when it was, what did he write it about, and what situation he was, and then you're wondering to yourself how a person that was like a hunted animal, that everyone tried to kill it and shooting and the animals trying to run and attacking from there and the hunters come from there. This is the situation was. Shaul and the soldiers and then Achitophel and his son of Shalom and all of these problems that he had in his life. How did he have time to talk to Hashem non-stop from such a level? I'll give you one example. When we have an enemy in our life, someone that hates us very much, hopefully you'll never have enemies, but sometimes you may have an enemy. If an enemy wants to chas v'shalom to destroy you, what would you daven to Hashem for? I'll tell you.
Don't destroy
you. I'll tell you. You will ask Hashem, save me from this guy. Save me, from this girl. Save me. Help me not to fall to their hands. I'm begging you. I cannot overcome the war by myself. I need your help. This is usually how people pray. But that's not how David HaMelech prayed. David HaMelech said to Hashem, if I am guilty, if I made one sin, if I deserve to get caught, make sure Shaul finds me, throw me on the floor, cut me to pieces and kill me. This is how we pray to Hashem. If I'm guilty, if I did something wrong, I deserve what I'm getting, not only don't protect me, make sure you find me, put me on the floor and cut me to pieces. This is the level of midat ha'emet. Who in the history had such a level of emet? If I deserve to die, what are you waiting for? You understand? This is just to show you to what level a person can reach. Not only is not selfish, not only is not asking, not only that, later when he had an opportunity to kill Shaul was in a cave, he had a sword, could kill him and get rid of the problem. And the Torah say, Abala or Gechash kem lo orgo. Somebody's on the way to kill you, you have permission to kill him first. Not a murder. Mitzvah. Protection, self-protection, self-defense. What did he do? He cut a piece from his coat. And he said, you see, I had an opportunity to kill you, but I didn't kill you. Why I didn't kill him? Because he knew he's a tzaddik. You are wrong about me. You don't want to kill me for nothing. You're making a mistake. You almost did kill me, but I'm not looking for revenge. Here, I just want to show you. I had you in my hand. But I didn't kill you because I have Yirat Shamayim. It's not about personal. Person can reach such a level, Lishem Shamayim. It's not about me. It's not about my honor. I'll give you an example. There used to be a big Rebbe. His name was Zdeh Chemin. Rav Chizki Amedini. One time, he was in yeshiva and he had one guy in yeshiva that was jealous with him. The jealous guy, he gave some money to the Arab maid to claim that this Chizki Amedini did some non-proper things with her. She came and made up a lie about him, Alila. The Rosh Yeshiva told him, I know that you never did anything. I know who you are, but everyone is already talking. It's very big Chilul Hashem in town. I need you to leave the yeshiva and leave town. Go a few months out of town, let the people forget about this incident. I will tell you when is the right time to come back to yeshiva. So he picked up his stuff and he left to far away city and stayed on his own. No friends, no yeshiva, no nothing. A few months later, this Arab woman felt guilty. She said, I destroyed the life of an innocent person. I have to find him. So she asked around, where is this guy that was kicked out of here? Where was he? So they told him where that she can find him. So she went, she knocked on his door. And when she arrived, she told him, listen, please forgive me for what I've done. This guy was threatening me, gave me money, I was foolish. I'm willing to confess in front of everyone that was all a lie. Please come back to the yeshiva. She's a cleaning lady of the yeshiva. Please come back to the yeshiva. I will confess. Just help me in one thing. Please tell the Rosh Yeshiva not to fire me. That I can still have my job. I need my job. So he got dressed. He was ready to come back. Then he started to think. And he said to her, you know what? I'm not coming back. I'll stay here. Go back, get your job, continue to work. Don't tell anyone that you came here. Let them think that I'm guilty. So she said to him, I don't understand it. I'm giving you an opportunity to clear your name. Everyone thinks that you're not a kosher guy and you're innocent and you turn it down. So this is his answer was, he said, huge, massive chilul Hashem we already had. That everyone thinks that I did what you claim. Now if I come back to town and you point at the other guy that he gave you money and he made up a lie about me and everyone would look at him and it would be another massive chilul Hashem. I don't want to upset Hashem. I will suffer all my life as long as this 1 week of chilul Hashem will not take place. I'll suffer all my life. I'll be here lonely. No marriage, no nothing, no yeshiva. My life will be destroyed forever. Why? Not to upset Hashem for 1 day, 1 week, whatever it was. He wrote in his book that from the minute he received this decision, his brain opened up. Up to that day, it was nothing special in learning. Just an ordinary guy. From that moment on, his mamash, like Hashem, replaced his brain. From that moment on, every book he was reading, 1, 2, 3, got all the things. Became one of the biggest rabbis in history. Every yeshiva is Sdechemet. So here we see how much a person can get for giving up. We saw in last parasha, Rachel Imenu, willing to sacrifice. Yaakov is her shiduch. Everybody knows it. She knows it. Yaakov knows it. She doesn't want to upset her sister. She gives her the simanim. She sacrificed her life not to embarrass her sister. But what about your life? Chayecha kodmin, the Torah says. Your life comes before the life of your sister. But this is a level of chassidut, midat chassidut. Yes, I have the right to defend my rights. I come first. It's my shiduch, it's not your, with all due respect. Thank you very much, sister. But listen, it's my shiduch. What, I'm going to live the next 40, 50 years, I'm going to suffer because I don't want to embarrass you one day. And if she would say it, did she make any avera? No. She has the right to say it. This is called midat chassidut. When you didn't have to, and you are willing to do it, that's a very big thing. Kadesh atzmecha b'mutar lach. People think what's allowed, allowed, what's not allowed, not allowed. But sometimes there's a level that even what's allowed, if you give it up, you sanctify yourself even higher. Because when there's something that you're not allowed to do, you're not allowed to do. What's the big deal? You're not allowed to steal. You're not allowed to speak Lashon Hara. You're not allowed to be Mechalel Shabbos. But when you are allowed, and you say, I'm not going to do it, L'shem Shamayim, for Hashem, that's a very high level. Any questions about what we spoke so far? Everything is clear? So the Tehillim, when you know the words, when you know the connection of the Mizmor, and you listen to the words that David HaMelech wrote in the hardest times in his life, it makes an amazing connection to Hashem. If you invest half an hour a day from your time for the rest of your life to read Tehillim, you will see, but to read Tehillim the way I described, you will see that your life will never be the same. You know, the Chazon Ish, he came to Bnei Brak back in a time, wasn't like today. Today, the rabbis become famous because of the media. If you are good, everybody finds out about you. Internet, websites, CDs. Back in a time, you can be the biggest rabbi in the world, 100 people hardly knows you. For the whole life. Maybe nobody knows about you. Why? Your lectures do not go past the yeshiva. You only hear, and then the same 100 people all the time that sees you the rest of your life, nobody knows. But today, travels everywhere, from different countries. Chazon Ish was, he came to Israel, few people knew how big he was, but he had stomach problem. Stomach digestion problem. So the doctor told him that he has to walk 1 hour a day, otherwise he will continue to suffer. Back then in Bnei Brak, 70 years ago, there was no, it wasn't crowded like now. You cannot put a needle now in Bnei Brak. It's very crowded. There were orchards open with oranges, trees. So the Chazon Ish walked by the orchard for an hour. Of course, he was learning Torah while he was walking. And there was one man over there, one full man, that was calling him every day from the terrace, "Hey! Batlan, go to learn." Batlan means lazy. Why are you wasting your time walking here between the oranges here? Go to yeshiva to learn, go to learn, go to learn. Every day the same story. So one day the men screamed to him, "Listen, if you don't like to learn, at least go read Tehillim. What is it going to give you to walk here in a field?" That's it. That was the story. One day this man got sick. This man that was screaming, he said, "I don't feel good, I need a bracha from a big tzaddik." They told him, "There's a very big tzaddik here in Bnei Brak, he came from Chutz La'aretz. We'll take you to him." They brought him to the house of the Chazon Ish. When they opened the door and he saw this Chazon Ish, every day he's yelling at him from the terrace, he got the shock of his life. He said, "This is the biggest rabbi in Israel? The biggest tzaddik?" "Yes, very holy, very serious, learning non-stop." "Wow, what a mistake I made." He came, fell on his knees. "Rabbi, forgive me, I'm so sorry. How am I supposed to know you're big Rav? I see you walking in the field." So the Chazon Ish told him, "Why, I owe you so much Hakaras HaTov." He said, "Why you owe me Hakaras HaTov? I disrespected you, I yelled at you every night, every day." So he told him, "Thanks to you, I'm reading every day Tehillim. I never read Tehillim before. When you started to scream to me, 'Read Tehillim, read Tehillim,' I said, 'This is Hashem sending me a message.' When I started to read Tehillim, because I learn non-stop, 18, 19, 20 hours a day. Now I put 20, 30 minutes a day to read Tehillim. It's not the same. Even a big chacham. Tehillim, especially for the ladies. Connection to Hashem. Learn the meaning of the words. They have it in English. Hebrew, English. One line Hebrew. Right underneath or above it, it says the words in English. Learn the words. Better to read 10 chapters of Tehillim that you know the words than to read 150 that most of them you don't know the words. Even if you repeat the same Mizmorim, doesn't matter. It opens the heart just as much every day. Until you know all the meaning of all the Mizmorim. Tehillim is mamash food for the soul. More things, of course, women has to learn Torah. The Torah say, the Gemara say, "Nashim torot mi mitzvot aseh shehaznan grama." Women are not obligated to keep mitzvot that are subject to specific time. Therefore, they don't have the obligation to learn Torah like a man. "V'agita bam yomam v'layla," the Torah say. However, many women do not know how much they have to learn. So let me clarify it to you. A woman that wants to be righteous, she has to learn at least 3 times more than what the biggest doctor in the world has to know. Let's do the math together. You have to learn all the laws of Shabbat. Right there reveals to know all the mukzeh, to cooking on Shabbat, hatrei, plata, blech, cover, not cover, here, the fire went off, shalom Shabbat, allowed to move the pins, not allowed, difference between Shabbat and Yom Tov. You have to know a lot of things in the kitchen. All the laws of kosher food, kosher, not kosher, you know, worms, checking the leaves, all these things you must know. All the laws of nida, mikveh, vila, chatzitza, all the prayers, right? You need to know all the parashot ha-shavua. Okay, you don't need to know shas. You don't need to know the ogmara, fine. But you need to know all the parashot ha-shavua, at least with Rashi, just the meaning of the parashot ha-shavua. Right there, you have the whole chumash, chamisha chumash Torah, it's a lot. Law of modesty, lashon hara, all the laws of lashon hara, rechilut, many other things. Yichud, at work, with the boss, with colleagues. If one day you go to work, your secretary, whatever you are, there's a lot of things to learn. If you add all the things that a woman has to learn, more than to become a doctor. How long a doctor has to learn? 7 years to become a doctor. You need a lot more for that. Just alone to learn Masechet Shabbat with all the halachot of Shabbat takes 7 years. To know it well, all the differences in the Muktzeh, all the so many things to learn, thousands of halachot. If a person doesn't learn how exactly he's going to be tzaddik, en am haaretz chassid. Some women, they count on their husband to tell them everything. So fine, if you have a husband and he's a talmid chacham, everything you'll be able to ask him until eventually you know everything. But what happens if you want someone that goes to work? It's not exactly a talmid chacham. What are you going to do? You and him will be stuck every day looking for the rabbi, making 50 phone calls a day to know what to do. Rabbi, I have this dilemma, I have this question, I have this, I have this, I have that, I have that. The rabbis are not exactly so available, right? For 50 questions a day for one person. So if you won't learn, you simply won't know. If you won't know, you break the laws of Hashem non-stop every hour of your life. And a woman does not have permission to break the law. What, a woman is less than a man? She's allowed to break the law, she's allowed to speak Lashon Hara. Some women, when I tell them to read Tehillim, Efo Rabbi, en li zman, I don't have a minute. 7 children, but you know, I walk half a day, I come, I cook, I have to pick them up from school, in the morning I have to send them to the bus. So I say to her, okay, you almost convinced me. Please tell me how long you spoke today with your friends on the phone. About the wedding, about the gown, about this, about the flower. They all begin to smile. I say, take the 1 hour a day that you speak nonsense on the phone, put it aside, dedicate it for Tehillim. Tehillim would bring you Olam Haba. The nonsense, Chas v'Shalom, will take you away from Olam Haba. Is it clear or no? It's very clear. The Torah, most of the things is black and white. There are some gray area that open for arguments, yes. But most of the things is very clear. Modesty, very clear. Shabbat, very clear. Lashon Hara, very clear. Reading Tehillim and be close to Hashem, very clear. You know, the Maharal Midiskin, he had an aunt. She was very sick and she was in a hospital connected to a host with a bed. You know, she cannot go to the bathroom, she cannot move out of bed. Once, after a while that she was in a hospital, very dirty hospital, not like the hospitals today, we're talking over 100 years ago. Very dirty hospital, horrible. The nurse come to see her once every 2 weeks. You understand? They put the bag for her. There is people that sell food. The shortage with people. The nurse just come to replace the bag once in 2 weeks. Unbelievable how horrible the hospital was. Today, if the nurse doesn't come in an hour, complain. So he say, let me visit my aunt. He came over there. He said to one of the girls there, tell her to be ready for me. I'm her nephew. I want to come visit her. So, when he walked into the room, the smell there was horrible, horrible. He couldn't breathe. So she said to him, I'm so happy you remember you have an aunt. So she said to him, I want you to give me a bracha. Give me a blessing. So he said, what do you want me to bless you for? She said that I should live long life. So he said to her, I cannot believe it. Why would you want to live long life in your condition? Why? What do you have in your life? You're laying in bed All year round, you do not move out of bed. You have to make your bathroom into a bag. Why would you want to live long life? So she pulled up the Tehillim from under the pillow there inside. She said, once every 2 weeks, the nurse come and replace the bag. And I have 2 hours that the bag is clean until I need the bathroom again. I have one, the bag is clean. As soon as she remove all the dirt, I take up my Tehillim and I finish the whole book for Hashem. So I'm able to read twice a month Tehillim. Once when they take the bag, after 2 weeks, I read the whole Tehillim. Then after the bag become full again, then I have 2 more weeks, then I read Tehillim. Meaning every month, I read twice Tehillim. That's all she has in her life. Nothing else, she cannot move. And you asking me why I want to live long life? I have an opportunity to praise Hashem and to talk in her situation. Who would like to be in her situation? You know anyone who would like to replace with her? You know, there were 2 men in a hospital, one by the window and one inside, 2 beds. The one by the window gets seizures from time to time. Every time he gets an attack, the other person has to press the emergency button. That's been going on for months. Every time this guy's starting to shake, he presses the red button, right away the doctor, the nurse, they come, they give him whatever they do. One day the guy inside, he got tired of his situation. Why? Because the guy by the window, he used to tell him every day, wow, what a beautiful lake. He looks out at the window. This kid's coming today with balloons, sunny day, there's a beautiful lake here. People come to the park with their children. He's inside, he doesn't see by the window. And he goes like this, and they say, you have no idea, there's ducks here, and there's some kind of a parade. And the guy inside is jealous. Why is by the window and I'm inside? One day when he got a seizure, the guy inside did not press the button. Let's get rid of him. As soon as he died, they'll move me in to the window. So, after he died, he pretended he was sleeping. The nurse came, she said, why didn't you press the button? So what do you want? I was sleeping. He died, and he said to her, listen, I feel very bad that he died, but now I'm here already for months. Push my bed to the window. Before you bring someone else to the room, make sure I get the window. So the nurse is looking at him. That's what you want? Fine. What do I care? You want to be by the window? Fine. So they move the other bed, and they push his bed by the window. And he's looking for the lake. What did he see? A hallway in the hospital. No lake, no park, no nothing. There was another floor by the hospital. The guy was making up stories. Lake, all kinds of things. And he looks outside and he sees nurses going by, people walking by in the hospital. No view, no nothing. Why did the other guy die? He was eating his heart, making him all kinds of lies. He killed him, and now he got nothing in the end. This is what life is all about. I call illusion. All illusions. These people run after these, run after that. In the end, we have the Torah, Baruch Hashem. And I'm telling you that the challenges are tremendous. There's a lot of problems. I gave a lecture this week in Brooklyn, and someone that I know told me to come to say Mazal Tov in an engagement party. Supposed to be full people. When I went to that place, I got the shock of my life. Usually I'm not naive. I know what's happening in the world. When I saw how the girls were behaving there, girls that supposed to call themselves full, how they were dressed and how loud they were. And there was a machine that take pictures and they all go like this. And I didn't know to laugh or to cry. I was in shock. Shock, totally shock. I said, this is what the religious world in Brooklyn became. This is what the community became. Hundreds of people, now one of them, tzaddik amiti. A man, alcohol, the way they dress. I said to myself, look. This is considered from people. And they are worse than the secular that I know when I was a child. The secular in my days were behaving more proper than the frum today, 30 years later. And I ask myself, this is what we're gonna end, this is how we're gonna end? Is this how we want to end? We want to end with high heels and a short skirt and tons of red lipstick and all kinds of things. And this is where we're in a place and making and scream, but all the men over there, the goyim, the waiters, they all look at her with no respect and to break the heart of Hashem. This is where we want to end. Be'ezrat Hashem, I hope you're clever enough to take the musar that you heard here tonight for the rest of your life. Usually you won't hear such hard talks. Because today, most of the speakers are afraid to talk too hard because they're afraid to turn people off. But smart person doesn't get turned off when he hears the truth of the Torah. He says, I have a lot to work on myself. I'm listening. I heard everything. Let me work on myself. That's a smart person. A foolish person complains. Ah, it's too strict. Ah, it's too much musa. Smart person saying, listen, I heard, I'm not in this level. I have to work on myself. Maybe next year I'll be in this level. This is the right way to look at Musar. No matter when you're going to hear or read Musar, Hazal said, someone that loves Musar is for sure going to be eventually tzaddik. Someone that hates Musar basically hates Hashem. Because who invented Musar? Where did Musar come from? All from the Torah. It's not people said and made it up. All come from the Torah. All the Sifrei Musar, everything that they ever say, I can show you in the Chumash. It didn't come from the moon. It came from Hashem. Yei Ratzon Bezrat Hashem, that all of you would graduate in the highest level. Bezrat Hashem, you have connection to Hashem, Dvekut. When the time comes, you find the right guys and establish kosher homes and have a healthy and happy life. Bezrat Hashem. And if you ever have questions, you can always send me questions, rabbimizrachi@gmail.com. Any kind of question, halacha, shkafa, problems in life, chas v'shalom. We try to help as much as we can. Thank you very much. Have a shavua.
Thank you so much.